Exactly.
How's that ever?
You have the best mic.
Oh my
God. You should get three like this.
I'm down. I'm really down to invest in more mics like
these
that.
Are yeah, the best. Those are the
definitely
best mics.
Buy more microphones. Microphone.
Just kidding.
You're testing it.
Spend your money. We'll be famous.
You can buy this on Amazon.
On Amazon. Actually, they go for like $300, but Alain Carlier, he used to work for the company that sells these microphones. $150, you could pick that microphone up. That's a pretty good deal. That's actually a very good deal for that microphone. But no, it's cool. It's cool. So nice watch you're rocking there, Fossil.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's a nice Fossil.
You got a new watch there, buddy?
Yeah, it's a new watch. I tried to start a collection.
You're into watches too, no, Noel?
I am into watches, and I'm almost exclusively into Nixons.
Nixons are nice.
I mean, you used to have Fossil. I've seen you rock a Fossil.
I've never worn anything but Nixons. I've tried. I really did. I really did. And then I was like, but it's not a Nixon.
Where do you buy the Nixons?
Actually, this is a pretty good secret of mine. I get them at Winners.
Really? That's a good one.
It's the shit. They have these watches that are $500, $400, $300 watches, and they range from $70 to $150.
Really?
There's going to be a lot of ugly watches.
Okay.
Yeah.
But there's still a lot of nice watches.
Definitely.
You have to catch them, though.
You have to catch them.
Yo, I swear.
What do you pay for a good watch? Like, how much does it cost?
Bro. You can't go under 100, bro.
It's minimum 100,
for sure.
Otherwise, you're kind of cheaping out.
Yeah, I feel like you cheap out.
Mm. What about G-Shock? G-Shock used to be in for a while. Those were like $200 plasticky looking watches.
You can have a nice G-Shock.
I never liked those. I thought those were ugly.
Yeah, they're
a
little bit.
I really thought ugly.
You know what? I picked one up for cheap, but only because my little brother had a good deal on it. He was just like, he was working at this Surf 66. He was just, hey, I have a good deal on something. So at the time, I was like, why not? But the watch was going for a lot more, but nah.
They're still good watches.
Honestly, I can't rock it just because.
Can you make it just a little less loud? It feels like it's like super
loud. It's a bit loud in your headphones.
Yeah.
In all headphones, I think.
Oh, yeah, it feels way better. I'm like, I'm talking at this level, and I feel like, in my ear.
Jesus Christ, you're like blowing the fucking eardrums. Is it better? It's better.
Yeah, it's much better.
I think like
a little bit louder.
I'm gonna be deaf from the left ear at the end of this.
Yeah, straight up.
Thanks,
it's very
Noel.
Strange.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean. Yeah, you just killed everyone's ear eardrums. Whoever was.
I was not ready for that.
I gotta say, okay. I kind of forgot.
We'll cut
that
it
was.
We'll cut it out.
We'll
cut it right there, bro.
I'll just put like a little musical right when you scream there, and just be like la la la.
Yeah.
So yeah. Yeah. I was gonna say
I would have brought three beers. I
was gonna say, where's the beer?
I know. Yeah, what do you think? Well, look.
Let's talk about this.
Yeah, look what's written.
High Life.
Right under High Life. Look what's written. I saw that and I was like,
the champagne of beers. There's no such thing as the champagne of beers.
Well,
but it looks nice.
This is quite
it looks
claim.
Nice. And it says High Life. So it's like a message from the Millers.
Definitely.
Telling us to smoke it up and drink it up.
Did you see the commercial for this beer? It was like an astronaut. It was a Mexican astronaut drinking this is a Mexican beer, right?
No, it's American.
That's American?
It's from Milwaukee.
So it's I saw some commercial with an astronaut or something, but with a Mexican astronaut drinking a U.S. beer. I don't know.
Maybe in your dreams.
What's a Mexican beer? Tell me a few Mexican
beers. Dos Equis.
Dos Equis, Corona.
Okay. Those are all good beers.
There's
Cristal.
Modelo.
Modelo was the commercial. That's the one. That's the one.
And, I
is
kept
that
going
a good beer?
On.
You could have got.
I was like, you're going to cut me there.
Keep naming me beers. Mexican beers. Mexican, go.
I ran out. I was really, it was actually perfect timing.
German,
I was hoping
go.
You weren't going to call me out.
Spanish.
Okay, go German.
Spanish. Yeah, German, let's see.
That's a good question.
Favorite
Bex?
German beer?
Bex.
Putting me on the spot here. The thing is Germany
Guinness
has,
from
get
Germany?
This, Germany has
no,
15,000 different beers, or over, for that matter. And anyways, what they're saying is you could have a beer every day, a new one, for 30 years and not try them all.
You're kidding me.
Yeah, there's that many beers.
Holy shit.
And somehow I could only say Beck's.
Somehow. But how come
there's only Beck's?
How come it doesn't make sense though that we're so limited in the beer that we get in Quebec? It doesn't make sense because I know there's so many beers like you just said, but we only get a certain amount
actually,
of beers here.
Now this is going to be interesting to you. I don't know if you've noticed the stubby bottles coming back. The stubby beers? Anybody?
I don't know.
Do you know what a stubby bottle is?
I don't.
You guys have you guys seen?
I guess I'm too young, bro.
No, you're not. I think you're just. What's that one from Jamaica? What's Jamaican beer.
Oh yeah.
Red Stripe.
Yeah. Red Stripe.
Have you guys ever seen a Red Stripe bottle?
I did try that.
Okay, but you know that what that bottle is? Okay. That is a stubby.
Okay.
So that's like the style of that bottle is a stubby, right?
Okay. Right.
Now in the 70s or whatever it is, the date I don't have, but my dad was telling me that all bottles that came into Quebec had to be a stubby.
Really?
Like, say you imported say you imported a Heineken bottle, like, well, if it's not a stubby, you can't sell it here.
But that's how the bottles were back then. They were all stubby.
No, not at all. Like, no. The producers had to make another bottle.
You know why it was made in that shape, though? Because these types of bottles that are like this, so easy to smash and break in a bar and cause fights. Those bottles were way harder to smash and get into bar fights. I'm telling you, I'm pretty sure that was the reason why they were in that shape.
I would have to
I'm
Google
telling you,
point.
I'm pretty convinced that that's the reason. Well, I wish we had a computer and we could check our facts right now. Where
we all
this
have
is the show
over.
With zero facts. Can we do that?
No. You could if you want. I'm thinking it's this. Now check it out.
I'm gonna check it out.
Is that all the shelves were a specific size and they were just too lazy to accommodate?
So what
everyone.
Is it? Stubby like, bottles? How would you pronounce that?
Stubby bottles.
Like
man,
what am I looking up right now?
That's gonna be pretty. I would not necessarily go into looking into that, but you could say. But Montreal stubby bottles and the
no, just
why they had to do that.
Why did they use stubby bottles
in Montreal? I can't give you the year. It's gonna be difficult to find, but if he finds it, he's a Google wizard.
I'm pretty sure it's out there. Someone thought about it. Canadian beer bottles. Do you know your history? Who the fuck took the time to do that?
Whenever I ask the so internet crazy. Anything, I find the answer. That's what I find so
oh
crazy.
Oh my god.
But what's the story behind the stubby bottle?
Offering.
Well, that's what I don't know. I know I know that it was the law that you could not produce or sell any bottles that
So
were.
Now we have this one. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. Now all the bottles have their own size. But what I was saying is
so
in
we
the grocery
can kill
store
now
and the grocery store the like Budweiser and what's it called? Coors Banquet, Blue, couple of the older brands have the stubby bottles available, like a retro bottle. Yeah. And then I brought them to a party, and my dad was explaining this whole thing, and now I'm telling you guys, but I have very little facts.
I've never seen them except the Jamaican beer.
Exactly, right? And that's why I bought it. Because, see, that's why I bought Modelo and a lot of other beers is the bottle, right? The bottles.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, that looks cool. I'll buy that. I mean, how else do you buy something, right? You want to try something new? It's, like, fucking hard.
Yeah, so I got zero facts.
I love
that.
The Coronas, though.
What?
I love Coronas.
They are nice. Now
they're easy to drink. And
do you like it with a lime in there?
For
I
sure.
I love a lime. You need it.
Yeah,
you
bro.
Needed lime.
Rona's all day.
But
Corona?
Yeah.
It has
Corona.
To be hot out.
I heard Rona. I was like, what?
That's what I said.
Okay. Rona's all day.
Rona's.
Do you guys feel that affects how you guys like Coronas? I feel like personally, I'll have a Corona
shout
in
out.
Winter, and it's like, eh.
Winter?
But if I have
shout
it
out
in
milk.
Summer hot day, it is like the water of the gods.
Exactly.
I swear. It just goes in just so like, you have a couple of these, and you just chill by the pool. But then it starts getting colder, and you're like, I go for something else. Very strange. I feel like that.
Corona's a nice summer beer for sure.
It definitely is, but
do
you guys
feel
like that about anything else? Like something
all day
you
beer.
Eat, and it's very climate oriented, where it being hotter is like, oh, this is more. I mean, like probably ice cream and that kind of stuff. You guys could
outside,
feel
bro, beer, Corona, lime,
all day,
baby,
every
hot
day.
Day for sure, hot day
the
for
best.
Sure.
Did you introduce
matters.
Us yet? Actually,
so good.
Yeah, actually, you guys, you've met before. No, a couple of times.
No. I'm saying, like, introduce us to the show.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. No, we know. This is one of those shows that we
just start
the podcast.
Up. Introduce
start...
yourself and introduce all of us.
Noel knows he's more professional than we are. No, at this point, we have this studio, and like I've been saying it more and more. Why not do these podcasts? So once and for all, welcome to the Vena Cava Hour, and I'm here with Vinny L'Etoile, famous...
not famous. Every time he's like, famous comedian, famous guitarist.
Famous.
Like, I don't know you. No one knows us.
And Noel Wahid. Nah, Wahid. He's known as Wizzy. He's known as Wizzy.
Young Wizzy.
Young Wizzy.
I actually just Low did that Wizzy. Because people were like, yo, you could get your identity stolen. I'm like, yo, if I change it to Wizzy, I'm safe.
Exactly, yeah. You might as well just do that.
So you're who?
Well, on Facebook and all like social medias, because they were taking your information.
Did you trademark it already?
I did not. And if someone else wants to be it, I mean, hey, the world needs more Noel Wizzies, you know? Yeah. We're a great breed.
Right. So what have you been up to these days? Doing any shows? I know you were talking about
I just
that.
Did a stand-up at the Showpartment.
Again? Nice. That was great. We did that.
Showpartment.
That was hilarious the last time you did that, man. Yeah. That was great.
I love
it. That was great.
And you know Joe Rogan? So you get listen to the podcast as well, Joe Rogan?
Yeah,
Joe Rogan. 100%.
Okay, so I was listening to him recently, and he was saying that what you need to do is create 1 hour a day where you have creative writing as if you
For
want to do
sure.
stand-up.
Good.
And I've
That's
been doing
good.
That, just committing 1 hour a day, and it really is incredible what you can produce in 1 hour. As
Definitely.
Much as it could be 3 jokes, 5 jokes, half a joke. It doesn't matter, but you're still putting something on paper. I put it on my phone and writing everything in, and I'm going to do a stand-up on Wednesday at the Comedy Works.
Oh, right on. Comedy Works.
Yeah, downtown.
Really? Okay, that's a famous spot.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
When is that?
It's going to be Wednesday at 8 p.m.
What's the date exactly?
Wednesday is the 14th
okay,
of
cool.
March.
Maybe we'll try to reach. That would be great.
Yeah.
We'll film it. Would you mind it? Can we film it?
All that.
Can we film it?
Yeah, sure. Why
we
not?
We could put it up on YouTube and stuff.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I'm for that. Definitely. Add that on the channel.
That'll be cool. We'll do that.
I'm trying actually a bunch of new jokes because I've been using, there's some jokes that I've used every single time.
Okay.
And now I just want to do like a fresh batch. And the show apartment.
Like the scarf one?
Sorry?
Like the scarf one?
Yeah, that one's done. I mean, I tried to do it again.
You're
like,
done
oh,
with the scarf?
It. I'm
yeah.
done. I'll bring it back if I have more time. But see, they give me 5 minutes, which is very little time. Once you've gotten comfortable, at first 5 minutes, I was terrified to fill it in. The first time I went was actually at the Comedy Works, and I was so scared. I went up, and they're like, "Oh, I told them how did I do?" And they're like, "Well, it was good, but you were too short, because I did like 3.5 minutes."
Okay.
Now the show apartment, he gives me all the time I want.
Perfect.
He's like, "Yo, what do you want to do? 10, 15 minutes?"
So how
just go
did
on.
You have
I can try new material?
Did you know your jokes all?
I know all
by
my
hand
jokes
at this point, or did you come up with your phone a bit?
I did. Originally, when I did it a couple first times, I only had 4 or 5 jokes. And I knew them all by heart. And then I brought new jokes in. And all it is a cue. But now I'm giving that up.
So
whatever joke I could think of.
So the last show apartment is on Friday the 30th.
Yeah.
So it's every Friday, the last Friday of the month.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you going to be on the next one?
I don't know. I just did the last one. It's rare that you like them
Double?
Simultaneously. Because he only does one a month.
Yeah. We need to go again.
Yeah, that's hilarious.
Yeah. But it's funny, too, because you kind of have to motivate yourself.
Was it all comedians?
What?
This time, was it all comedians or there was artists, musicians?
There was. Actually, it was pretty cool. There was one of the guys was a comedian, but he was also a freestyler. And he passed a pad around to everyone. And he said, "Listen, write something down on the pad. And at the end of the show, I'll rhyme to it." So he passed it around to everyone. There's maybe 30, 40 people there. Bunch of random words. And this guy lit the microphone up.
Really?
With all these words.
It was nuts.
I can just
this
imagine.
This guy was spitting fire. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of Big Pun.
No.
Heard
of Big Punisher. Sounded just like him.
Really?
Yeah. Big Punisher is the bomb.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Fuck.
So he rapped all the words.
Oh, yeah, straight
freestyle.
Up.
And so you hear your word coming and you can't wait till it's yours. And then you laugh because it's yours that just came up.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what I would do. That's awesome,
crazy,
bro.
That's hilarious.
We missed that. We didn't miss that.
When was that?
I liked it the last time, bro.
A couple weeks ago.
Yeah, it was 2 weeks ago.
The
no, it was, when was the last first Friday?
The last time we
last,
went.
Last
yeah,
Friday.
Just let us know and we'll definitely come for that.
Cool,
that's
yeah.
Sure.
You remember the
no,
last time
it's
we went?
Fun.
It was like there was like at least 3 artists and
right?
one singer. Remember? And the
yeah,
last
yeah,
one
the singer
was,
great. Was
like
really good.
Crazy. The last guy was really funny. It's like he
yeah, that
he
last
prepared,
guy. Remember
like,
that at that show that you did?
He prepared a fucking
yeah.
show.
Who was that guy?
Which guy are you referring to? Describe
just
him
the
to me.
Very last guy.
He
had
an older
a couple
man.
Jokes.
He was almost bald. And
No, he wasn't bald. He was probably in his late 30s.
Yeah,
or
he was
late,
almost bald.
Maybe early 40s.
Man, that is a good question. Oh, well, when you guys came.
Yeah. When we came. There was a joke. few jokes that this guy did, that was
a headliner.
Remember,
was
he was like, hey, it's...
Not the Australian,
it's 2017.
He was like a real comedian, you know?
Like, oh, man. That guy
was good.
That guy was good.
He does that shit professionally.
The fuck?
Yeah, he had a show ready and everything. Yeah, I couldn't believe it.
He had 30 minutes of, like, stellar material.
And I laughed the whole time almost. It was all like prepared, very thought of. Like,
it seems like someone like that. It wasn't like a short joke. At that point, like, I'm sure he's done some pretty big shows. It's just,
I actually haven't heard of him, and I don't know.
That's the thing. It's like you got to brand yourself. You had mentioned before the podcast online. You got to be online these days. You do have to be online. Just put yourself out there a little bit.
Well. I feel like it'd be like that way for you guys are producing music, right?
Right.
Whereas you can communicate with your following in a different way that a stand-up comedian would. Okay. What's nice about what you have is you can produce something that can be recorded and listened to over and over, and to the point where you might not even have to look at this. You could just listen to it in the background and enjoy it. The difference between stand-up is it requires an audience. Like a live audience every time. So just you need that to gauge your jokes to eventually get to a place where your jokes are crisp.
That's 100%.
All these stand-up comedians, it's insane. They go out. Some of them go out every night. Every night. For every sure. night do a little stow. Try it out. Try the material. Like
definitely.
Before they do the big ones, and it's nuts.
You got to try out those jokes. You got to see which ones land, which ones don't. And
you like do you like people that do also like improv where they kind of like, they pick the public and they kind of make fun of them.
Well, I do actually. You got to be quick on your feet because it's you never know what kind of crowd you're going to get. And I'm trying to adopt that. And right now, I've actually written down kind of jokes that if I get a dud, I have a joke.
Okay.
You know, because you kind of have to assess it. If someone, if it doesn't laugh, you got to say something after that.
Exactly.
Would kind of.
So you have like something.
Carry the crowd over.
You have a bullet. You got another bullet ready just in case something happens.
Right, exactly.
That's perfect.
You know? Yeah, that's true. But it rarely happens, though.
Well, and it definitely can, because crowds are very different. I've seen a lot of comedians
fail,
do well, medium, and great.
Yeah.
The same ones.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's so strange. I'm like, wow, you fucking nailed it. And then I'm like, ah, you just.
The way I think you say it, too. It's
you
not
know what?
Just
I'm not
like,
a comedian, but what's
it's
cool
not
about
jokes.
Listening to the Joe Rogan podcast is that comedy and music, like you had mentioned, there's a little bit of differences. But the thing I could say that's the same is that we're entertaining the audience, basically.
Definitely.
But the difference is that comedy, you kind of have, you know, maybe even your best jokes, you're going to have to retire eventually. Unless you're the type of comedian that you want to carry on the same jokes for like 2 years. Honestly, we all know those comedians that, have you ever been to a comedy show and you've seen that comedian a million times on YouTube or whatever, and then they do those jokes and you're just like... Yeah, it's great. And again, from the Joe Rogan podcast, from what they say, it's like the comedians that are almost like expected to do certain jokes because they gained a certain level of fame.
Right.
That it's like the fans want to hear those. There's a certain percentage of fans that want to hear those jokes, but there's another percentage that just want to hear fresh stuff. And I'm with the people that want to hear fresh stuff.
Who doesn't?
So, but there is a percentage of people that they're waiting for that joke that you... They're waiting for you to say that pun or whatever it is that you said online that was super funny. And that's what fucks with comedians. So me, I would say, if you can write constantly, that would be great, man. But with music, I could write a song and it could be a hit and just be a hit forever. And every time we play a show, that song needs to be played. It needs to be played. That song, if it's not...
How do you feel about that?
That's the thing. I'm in the type of mentality where I'm going to write a song that I'm aware of this outcome. I'm aware that we might have to play these songs a million times. So I want to write a song that I really want to play. I'm not going to write something I don't want to play. If I do that, then I feel like you're losing a lot of the inspiration aspect, because we don't necessarily write music for anything. Like, besides for us, like when I write music, it's for me, for the band, but that's it. But the great thing about it is that it could hit a lot of people, and that's what we're hoping. But first and foremost, we write music for us. That's the crazy thing. We write it for us, but we know that there's a world that's ready to listen to it too. But if you write music for yourself, that's how it flows properly. If you write it in a way where you're just trying to get money and stuff like that, I don't think it's going to flow properly. You're going to get music that's artificial. Mm. And we've been together, I calculated now, 8 years. So
I guess it's the same thing when he writes too, you know? Like, he has to really do something he wants for himself.
I never thought of it that way, actually.
The jokes that you enjoy that actually makes you laugh, I think. Well, that's what the public's going to like, I guess.
One thing
that you find funny.
I couldn't agree with you more. Is there's one thing that I did notice in,
like, I laugh through your perspective sometimes. Like, when I see someone, I laugh kind of through their perspective, you know? Some people will talk from their family and stuff. We're not really, like, some people are native too, or, like, not native, but they're, like, ethnic, different ethnicity, and you can laugh kind of through it kind of thing. You understand? Like, I'm not, like, Indian, but, like, if a guy was to explain something funny about his culture, then I'd probably laugh through him, you understand? I would understand, like, his, you know what I mean?
Definitely.
You understand what I mean?
I'm not sure exactly what you're talking about.
I think what you're trying to say
just talk in the mic if possible, because I can barely hear.
Oh, okay, okay.
I think what you're trying to say is,
my bad.
That's all good.
When you describe it in a way that it feels like you can understand it, you can visualize it.
His point of view. Yeah, you can understand his point of view. You understand what I mean?
Okay. No, I'm still not sure. Say it again, one more time.
Well, if you say it in a way that allows the person to themselves visualize it in their mind what was going on, it's more than just having said it. If you set them up and you allow them to create a mental image themselves,
yeah,
it allows the joke to flow
being
better.
Being in his shoes.
Exactly.
You understand? Because most of the time he's saying shit that he saw or stuff like that, right?
You got to build it in or whatever it is. Because you could just say the joke.
Yeah.
Or you can say, hey, I was there. It was Tuesday.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Snowing, whatever.
Like, no. Yeah, exactly.
You know,
that's so true. You make people feel like through you.
Comedy is definitely, it's different from music. You gotta really, you're taking comedy is actually different. You're fucking making the people listen to you, and they can't even make exactly. You have to. You're grabbing their full attention to the point where they can't even talk. If they talk, they're screwing up your flow, and then.
I could, in theory.
It's tough, man. But I believe you're a funny fucking guy. And if you carry on what you're doing, man, like, keep pushing. Eventually, you're going to pass through this barrier, I believe. Honestly, there's a certain amount of hours that you do need to put into it to pass these barriers. But you are a funny guy. You have the look. You have the sound of voice. You have everything that you're doing. You're doing everything right is what I think. And just keep pushing. You need to put yourself in uncomfortable positions to thrive. So what that might be going to the, maybe it's 2 shows a week, or maybe it's 3 shows a week. I don't know what it is, but put yourself
like
in a position.
One show a week.
You got to, man, because I do see you doing this for a living. Why can't you do this? You had mentioned it last podcast, 50,000. Hell no, man. You could make much more if you did it. If you branded yourself properly, did it successfully. Vince too, man. You're very
successful. I think like, yo, as long as he's doing what he's doing right now, he's not losing the passion, you know?
For sure. It's all about the passion. I definitely see what you mean.
I'm just trying to boost your and give
definitely.
You motivation.
Hey, man, those are kind words, and I appreciate them.
You're a funny fucking guy, and just keep doing what you're doing, man, because I'm telling you, man, it's going to be great. I could see 10 years down the line. I know we mentioned that a few times, too, but 10 years is a long stretch, but honestly,
for sure.
It's just a realistic step. But 10 years, if you keep doing what you're doing, it's going to hit at one point. Maybe you're going to get a special. Netflix will pick you up.
Yeah.
That wouldn't be too bad. You know what I'm saying? Like,
That's what I want to start doing is I definitely want to start. It's a little bit of a commitment, though.
You know what
it's
we should do? Let's do some, like, funny videos where we go to, you know, like, good restaurants that are not too expensive, and we do something funny with you we go eat, and some comedy, we make a twist out of it, we let the restaurant know we're gonna do a video, and if they're cool with it, then everything's cool. If they're not, we're not gonna do it there, and we'll pick a time and spot where there's not too much people, and you know what I'm trying to say, but we do it a funny twist, give it a little twist. And honestly, food is something that we could all relate to. I'm telling you, I've been thinking about it since the last couple of years, that food is one of those things that I want to do videos with. because I used to watch a lot of like Chef Ramsay, and it taught me a lot about the restaurant business, but it also taught me about like good food, and I definitely want to do some type of videos with food. It would be really, really cool, and we all go and we do a funny twist. It'll be really cool. Anywhere and anything. We'll go eat some Indian food, Chinese food. We'll go get some Italian.
Review every restaurant in Montreal.
However you want to do it. But we'll make sure it's good restaurants. We're not going to go to review some shit.
We'll do like a vlog of like going
to
restaurants.
If you want to do a vlog, we can do a vlog. But I'm thinking more of like some 5-minute video of wherever we're going. And then it's like funny video.
A vlog. But it's like, it could be 5 minutes, bro.
However it is. However
it is. You could cut it that short.
You'd be done?
Sure.
Think of a restaurant.
You try some crazy good restaurants, bro. Anywhere. And give her good, like, opinion about it and what we don't like, what we do like, and how it tastes.
For sure.
How it tastes, bro.
That's basically what we're doing.
And what we're trying out, too, bro. All the stuff we're doing. Everything should be on video.
And we get really blazed before the fucking...
Straight up. I got 2 stone last time, and now I took 2 puffs, and I think I'm exactly where I could be.
That's where you
want to
be? And then you got the Miller...
It was
high life
last
beer.
Time you were saying something and I was looking at you and I'm like, oh man,
I'm zoning out into the void.
Know what he said.
Vince can handle his smoke. We're all pretty strong. Well, yeah. How come some people have different tolerances?
I gotta say, it's weed is a commitment.
You need to
smoke all the time to keep the tolerance.
Okay.
If you don't smoke every
day, I do agree.
If you don't smoke every day. Fucks you up when you hit it, like say it's just 1 joint a day, right? Okay, no problem. Skip 2 days, you get another joint, you're like, whoa. And me, it's on. I'm trying not to own weed, and whenever I go somewhere, I give them $5.
You
want to
hear something crazy? Okay, because I know how you are with edibles. I know you took like one brownie and you were
fucking gone.
How high were you for a few days or something? No,
no
it was like
no,
a
no,
day
no.
or something.
I
you woke up the next day, you were pretty baked.
It's like me.
I did actually do brownies the first time, and I did way too much. I don't know how much we did. We had a bunch of Buddha butter and made brownies, and I had 2 big brownies. And without exaggeration, we made these at noon. We were eating them by 1. I was stoned by 2. And for real, I went to bed stoned that night, and I woke up the next morning. And I don't know if I was still hungover or if it was groggy, but... Until maybe 11 the next day, I was like, yo, am I ever going to stop being stoned? This is crazy.
That's hilarious.
Does that ever happen to you guys where you eat a lot of edibles and you're
well, that's what I was about to say. I'm
going to
tell you a funny story. Yeah, it was Vince's birthday last week, and we went to eat sushi at Aikawa. I invited you. You weren't down, but it's okay. We were supposed to do a podcast. It didn't pan out, but what happened is we went to eat the sushi, but right before we ate sushi, I had a couple edible brownies, and I gave one to Vince and one for me, 120 milligrams each.
Is that a lot? For those who
apparently
don't know what
it's
that means,
apparently
that?
It's a lot. I cannot tell you exactly, but from what I hear, it's a decent amount,
well,
even for people
you,
like
what
us.
What gets you stoned?
Apparently 60 milligrams can fuck you up.
60. Okay, so this is like a double dose.
This is like a double dose, I guess you could say, yeah.
And does it affect you in the same way alcohol does, where you'd have one beer and then you have a second beer
well,
and affect
see,
you at that rate?
See, this is what I'm about to say. What happened was we eat the edibles right before we ate sushi. And we start eating the sushi, like 20 minutes into eating the sushis and whatever so much food that we had, we were getting higher and higher. I saw it in Vince's face. He was just like zoning out more and more as we were eating. And same as me, but I was trying to hold it together. And Vince, too, I could see he was holding it together. But you know when someone's high, you just, like, you look at someone and you're like, you're so fucked up. Like, you could tell someone walks in the room and they're baked. You're like,
we were literally having
a
conversation and I had to stop in and say, like I was like, I'm high right now.
Like,
and him, too, he was like.
It kind of felt like everyone knew you were high. It's like one of those moments where you're just like, every time the waiter comes to pour you water, you're just like, it feels like this guy knows I'm high. Like, oh, my God.
Isn't that an interesting thing? That's exactly paranoia.
No, but so let me finish the story. We eat the sushi. We go home. We go back to my place to smoke a few joints. You know, that's okay. For some reason, edibles and smoking is 2 different things. And
I got fucked.
It's so fucked up because... Weed is going to be legalized very shortly in Canada, and I kind of feel like a lot of people that don't smoke weed or have never smoked in their life are going to be like, I kind of don't feel like smoking, so I'll try an edible. Mm. And they're going to think that is what smoking is like.
Yeah.
And the problem is is it's really not the same goddamn thing. Because it's not processed the same way when you eat it. It hits you an hour later. It gets processed by your liver. Apparently it's like H24, whatever. It's complete. It's hydroxy 11. It's not THC, basically.
It's your liver that breaks it down. Exactly. As opposed to absorbing it through oxygen, it goes through your blood. So you'll feel it right away. And a lot of people, it's very common, they'll have the brownie. Half an hour goes by, they feel nothing. They have the second brownie. And then 30 minutes later, the first brownie's hitting them, and they're like, whoa.
So
am I going to hit this other one? And that, I could totally hear you.
So what happened is this. We go home. We smoke a couple joints just to mellow out. And, like, actually, Vince didn't even smoke. He was like, I'm out of it, man. I'm fucked up. Vince was fucked. You were so out of it, bro. Yeah, I was the most that I've ever seen.
Yeah.
But for some reason, I was just like.
Yo, I was like this, bro.
You were so out. I was so out of it, too. But for some reason.
Was it still enjoyable?
Couldn't keep my eyes closed, bro. Open. I was like. Literally, like, you remember you were looking at me.
No, but this is where it gets crazy. It's like, I knew I was messed up, and I knew Vince was messed up, and I was just like, you know what? We get home from the sushi. I specifically told Vince while we were eating sushi, I'm like, I'm going to eat another brownie when I get home. But that was before I was so high. But because I said it, I was like, you know what? I'm going to do it. I took a brownie out of the freezer. I go downstairs, and I show Vince. I'm like, you want to split it? He's just like, nah, man, I can't. And for some reason, it's the biggest brownie that I've ever seen. It was just like cut bigger than any piece that was the biggest piece I took. I happened to take it. It was just the biggest piece.
Probably more than 120.
It was probably more than 120. I was like, this is a huge piece. And I was just like, all right, I'm going to eat it. So this is my second brownie, basically like 2 hours after the sushi. 2 hours in total after the initial brownie. And what happened was, I would say an hour later, Vince left, or it was an hour and a half later, you left. And that's when it started really kicking in, because I had all this sushi on top of the brownie, so it didn't break down until the sushi
went
it had to break down. So once, when I went to bed around like 10:30, that's when it started hitting me even more, man. It was the weirdest feeling. I couldn't sleep, man. My whole body, my legs were pressure and everything. I was like, what the fuck is going on? I had to get up. My chest was giving me like anxiety. It was like, I was literally having a panic attack. Like, fuck. I've never had this before. I regretted it. Like, you can't imagine. It was 2 a.m. when I finally went to bed. I was like, what the fuck, man? Like, I went to bed and I woke up and didn't feel too great kind of thing.
I swear. Did not feel the greatest.
I didn't enjoy it. I feel it's too much. It's so much. Brownies, I'm like, do I really?
So, speaking of people that don't smoke and eating edibles.
Oh, right. That's what we were getting at.
Speaking of that, my bassist, who never smoked in his life, okay? He never smoked in his life. He never drank. Or he only recently started drinking beers, okay?
Oh, shit.
But, you know, this is where it gets crazy. It's that he doesn't want to smoke, which I understand. I'll never impose any smoking on anyone. And I respect that. But when he knew we had edibles, he had mentioned that he would be down to try it. So I had a 60 milligram cookie that I split in half one time and I gave to him. And me, I just ate the other half. It didn't do anything to me, but I thought maybe it would do something to him. And he told me it didn't do anything. I was like, okay, so 30 milligram technically didn't do anything for him. So one day he came to the studio, like a few weeks after that. He came to my house. I offered him a cookie and a half, meaning 60 milligrams.
90.
And oh my God, this was the fucking worst disaster I've ever seen.
Triple the dose.
Dude, I'm telling you, man. It was like, we're coming to the studio. He was going to come home and eat supper at our house, have wine, and there was going to be a major supper. He's a vegetarian. We're going to have a great meal at our house. But we leave the house right after he eats the cookie and a half. We go to the SAQ to pick up a bottle of wine. Come to the studio. Out of nowhere, he's just like, I'm hungry. So he goes next door to get some food. He comes back with a plate of potatoes. And he just sits there and eats the whole thing of potatoes. He does not move. He just sits and eats the entire thing of potatoes. And we start jamming. He doesn't want to start jamming with us. He's just sitting there. He cannot move. He's glued to the chair. I started getting worried, man. It was like, I didn't want to stress him out, but I could tell he was like not feeling too great. He was just like, I don't feel great. And I kept going to check up on him. He was just passed out. Finally, we went back to my place. We go in the jam room. We're all sitting around, enjoying a smoke, talking, having a good time. I looked at him. I put Harold and Kumar. He loves that movie. He's like, ah. I'm like, well, you got to watch this movie High, man. This is a movie you got to watch High. He was not enjoying it. He looked at me at one point, and he had the face of a guy that was just like, oh, no, the worst thing's going to ever happen in the next 5 seconds. Like, that face where it's just like something really bad's going to happen in the next 2 seconds. You're just like, what the fuck? So he looks at me as I'm puffing away, and he goes like this. He has his hand in front of his mouth. Oh, fuck, he starts yakking all over the place. Thank God it didn't hit me. Nothing went near me. It just went all in the vicinity where he was. I leave the
potatoes everywhere.
Listen, exactly. I leave the room potatoes. To go get something to clean up all this shit. I come back, bro. It's like a goddamn Niagara Falls of throw up all over the floor, man. It was the
like
worst.
Like a lake.
I left and came back, and it was the whole room was fucked. I was like, oh my God. What the hell? How am I supposed to judge this shit? Half a cookie does nothing. I'm like, I'll give him 1.5 cookies. Like,
I would have definitely gone up to 1 cookie.
I don't understand.
1.5 was a bad move.
Yes, yeah. At first, I gave him a cookie, but then I ate a cookie, and then I ate another cookie, and then I ate half a cookie, and I wanted to give him that other half. See, that? The problem is that
that extra half is huge.
You can't.
I'm telling you.
Never smoked in his life.
Yeah, I swear that night I almost wanted to puke, but I was not like your friend. Like, I was able to control like my high.
But you can see how that could happen, though. Huh?
Yeah,
me too. I kind of didn't feel the greatest at one point.
Those edibles, it's
because of the food we ate, bro. You can't eat anything else. You eat the edibles and you jam on it. If you eat something else,
that is possible.
It's gonna digest badly, bro. Trust me. That's why you burp it all.
Got
That's
it,
what
man.
Happened, I think. Because it wants to push the brownie through.
But see, so what's your take? Is it a good thing, edibles?
It's a good point that you should say that. Actually, it's completely different.
It's
Whereas
fucking
smokable
different.
Is it so much lighter.
No, but that experience that I just told you with the two brownies, it led me to, like, not enjoy. It wasn't a fun experience. It wasn't like, yeah, I had a great time. It was like,
I'm too stoned.
It was not the greatest experience. It was a little bit uncomfortable. It kind of doesn't make you want to do it again.
I have gotten two stones on a couple of occasions, and I just said, you know what? Just take an amount that you're like, ah, that is perfect.
Exactly.
It's like drinking too much.
Yeah.
It is. That seems
but
similar
like
for
a buzz
some
where you're just like, okay, I don't want to ruin this. This is nice. I'm exactly where I need to be right now.
But the thing is, like, you can overdose kind of like the amount of brownies you eat. But the smoking, you can smoke.
No,
as
I don't
much
think
you
can
want.
Overdose with brownies.
Not overdose.
No,
though.
You
that,
can.
No, what I mean
maybe.
Is like
you can
do too much, kind of like the alcohol, where you take too much, where you feel like you're gonna like.
Well,
yeah.
Well, can I say something? When my bassist ate the brownie,
food still, bro.
I wasn't worried of him like overdosing or anything. I was actually, from what I was seeing, I was more worried of him like walking into a wall, falling on the floor, because he was doing stupid things that he would normally not do. And that would cause some type of accident. If you know what I'm trying to say, like,
yeah.
It's kind of like when you're drunk. You do dumb stuff that causes accidents and very similar things like that. But to someone like me and you, who were very tolerant, it's not going
to
happen to us necessarily, but to him.
Because we know what to
someone
expect.
That doesn't
he
smoke,
doesn't know.
My best advice would be to go as light as possible.
He should just get like a couple puff, and that would be it for his first time.
Like,
and then
I'm not
puff.
A, I'm
like,
not here to it. Give anyone advice.
No, no,
that's
no,
not what I'm here for.
If he doesn't want to puff, he doesn't want to, bro. That's it.
But I would say if anyone's gonna do it and they never tried weed and they have zero experience, to try the least amount of
go
edibles
low
as
on
possible.
The edibles.
Yeah, definitely.
And like
start low.
If anything, maybe try vaping.
Vaping is actually exactly what I'd recommend. To start you off would be vaping.
Yeah, vaping
and then you
is
move
good.
Move your way up to like a regular joint, and then
bro.
And then from there, after that, it's
if
all gets pretty
fucking
crazy. Like,
did you guys see that video of that old guy smoking a pipe for the first time? He starts burning it at the bottom like a crack pipe. He's like, "I'm gonna smoke a pipe." So I've never smoked weed in my life, and he pulls out this glass pipe, puts the weed inside. He starts burning at the bottom like it's crack or something.
Yeah, I think
you
I saw
that.
That.
He's like puffing. Yeah. Why isn't it working? Let me try burning it in. let me try like a pipe, like a tobacco pipe. And then you see him put the flame in the weed, and it's like his face lights up, like, oh my God.
Where did you see that?
I don't know. It's just an old video. I find it funny. I kind of think it's set up. It's some guy that did a funny video like
that.
Can
I get actually a little bit less volume?
Yeah, sure.
Sure. Which one am I?
Yo, I need to pee, man.
Yeah, go for it, man.
Yeah, intermission? It's not a bad idea.
This is like...
We could take a little break. We'll take a little break and we'll come back. We'll pause this up.
I saw a Lambo yesterday, bro. It's so cold. And there's still a Lambo outside. I couldn't believe
it.
Doesn't
make sense.
This guy pulled out a Lambo already. I had to film it and
wrote. Are you kidding me?
I wrote, this guy already took out the Lambo. Because, yeah, that was a nice one, bro. I'm pretty sure it was a Ventador, but.
It really doesn't make sense to pull out a Lamborghini in this weather.
Couldn't believe it. I saw it from far and I was like, is that a Lambo? I thought at first it was Audi
R8. So what do you do when you own a Lamborghini? Like,
You don't take it out in the winter, bro.
You definitely don't take it out in the winter.
That's a dumb move. I don't know. This guy's rich or something, bro. It doesn't give a shit.
You don't bring it to
this
Montreal.
This is a nice-ass car, bro.
The roads are so bad.
This is like taking the nicest car and putting it in the worst weather. Like, that sucks, man. It really sucks.
Doesn't make sense.
To me, it breaks my heart to see this because I'm driving my Honda, and I hate putting my Honda in the winter, through the winter, but we all have to go through it. And most people that have nice cars, they use a beater or something else to drive the winter and keep their nice car clean for the summer, right? This guy probably didn't give a fuck, but it's not even his nicest car, maybe. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
Yo, for sure. For sure. Up and
at that point, if you're driving,
I swear, bro, that was on
really
Sources.
Probably really not your nice.
I was going towards BuzzFit on Sources, so strange. And I was there.
I mean, really getting winter tires on a Lamborghini just feels.
Yeah, really.
Ridiculous.
What the fuck? It's true, huh? That's, you think he had winters?
True, right? You do need your winter tires at this point.
And I mean, you have no clearance. It would be the stupidest thing to drive.
But yo, it wasn't that snowing like as much as it is right now. But I couldn't believe it.
Unreal.
Anyways, what's the nicest car you have driven? I know you drive.
I've been fortunate. I work at a shop that allows me to pick up my clients' cars and bring them back to the shop. I take care of that kind of thing. And I've driven a fair amount, but none of the crazies. I mean,
but what's a
actually
nice
I've
one.
Driven a lot. Actually, let me just
throw a nice one out there.
Let me just open my Instagram of like a bunch of them.
But you know some.
Okay. Off the top of my head, I've driven a Rolls Royce Ghost.
Okay, really? That's
2016.
Wow, that's G.
A drop top, orange interior. Yo, this thing was so baller. This is actually another Rolls Royce. That was
how far though?
It's black
on
black Phantom that he had originally, and then he changed it for a Ghost. Same thing, black on black with 24s. Cracked his wheels. We sold him new wheels. That was a cool car to drive. But the most pimp one, yo, he's got this Rolls Royce Dawn. Orange interior, like that, black outside, but the whole interior is flashy orange, drop top convertible, massive. Just driving around, like I want people.
It's like
to
a
look
boat,
at me.
Unreal.
It's a boat.
Yo, you're driving $500,000.
But
you've
driven like crazy,
more than
crazier
that,
cars
no?
than that, no?
Well. Monetarily, those would be the most expensive, definitely.
Really? Oh, I see.
And one thing I'll tell you, I've driven a lot of fast cars, and I feel like I want to drive fast. You drive
right.
a Rolls Royce, and it's like nothing matters. I'm not even kidding. You drive it, and it's so smooth. Like, you don't even want to drive fast.
Really?
The whole time I was driving that one, I was driving pretty much the speed limit, or maybe 5 kilometers over.
What's the thrill out of a car like that then? At that point,
being
well, that's what.
Just
what
to get the look, or yeah. was there something about
all,
it that just stuck
there
out?
There is status, but that one is not about performance. It's about comfort,
okay. Luxurious,
like complete luxury.
I agree.
Bro, but, this is a pimp car, bro.
But it still definitely. Drives pretty like, fucking fast if you
only
wanted to.
Jeep people like
expensive, man.
But what
ridiculous.
Else? What's the sport car?
I've driven a Lamborghini Gallardo.
Yeah,
I
think I saw you cool. on Instagram with that. That was pretty sick.
Lamborghini Gallardo was sick. Wow. Same thing, convertible.
Fuck.
Yo,
nice.
I get the car. Okay, this
How
is the first time.
How far do you go
this...
though? Where do you go? Like distance or no?
It depends. It depends on what we're actually doing.
The Lambo, did you drive it a lot or not?
I
That's
drove
my
it
question.
A decent little amount. I got...
You got people to turn heads.
I got it on the highway a little bit and was able to open it up. I was able to open it up a couple spots and it was... I totally get why people buy these things. You press that and it's like, whoa.
It's like a space.
Just what about traction control? Was it?
I didn't really fuck with the controls, to be honest.
No, but like, you didn't lose traction at
no,
all.
These cars no, are no, built no, for like, speed, bro.
The Lamborghinis are so wide and so low that your stance is
you're on the
glued
ground,
to the road.
Yeah.
Yo, it's amazing. I went over this overpass at 140 kilometers. Like, I was, you don't want to go too fast anywhere because, I mean, there could be a cop somewhere.
Yeah,
you could
this
definitely.
This is a spot where it's usually nobody.
Yeah.
And I just opened it up on that and it was insane. It went 140
delicious.
Down to 30 at the curve and maybe
in the summer
300 meters, Jesus. Not even. It was like nothing. Just, and it felt so smooth. That's what's different, I notice, about fast cars is when you drive them, someone else is like, say I'm driving around my jet and someone flies around me way fast. I'm like, God, this guy's going so fast. But these cars, it's a different experience. They handle the road so well that you, even if someone came, you feel like you'd be able to turn around them. It's so.
Yeah, you can dodge them.
It's
easy.
Hard to explain. There's a driver's experience that,
really?
goes with these hypercars.
Oh, that's sick.
And then, yeah, those.
You had the roof off?
Yeah, that was crazy.
So you're balling, you're like hair going like head and shoulder commercial. Yeah. Like, wow.
M3s, M4s.
M3? Okay, wow, now we're talking.
X6Ms. The Bentayga. I drove the Bentayga. This is the most expensive SUV in the world. It's like 400 Gs.
Bentayga?
And typically I'd get to drive the cars like...
Who makes
If
that?
You're wondering the distance, it's probably like 2 to sometimes... 90 kilometer range. It depends where I'm going, but more commonly it would be, I'd say 5 to 15 kilometers is usually the amount I'm gonna drive these cars.
Exactly. You're not taking it for a spin for 45 minutes kind of thing. You're just going for 10 minutes.
Well, depends how far the client is. Exactly. Sometimes it's like, I drove a Boxster all the way up north, like way past in this little windy turny road, and it was like. Yes.
No way.
There's so many times that I'm driving these cars, I can't even believe that I'm driving them. Fuck. The RS3, I'm going to just do a quick summary. I'm not going to give them all. I'm just trying to. Okay, so I've driven pretty much most of the 3 Series, the 2 Series, 1 Series. Most of the BMWs is, yeah. I have not driven the i8. I had the chance, but we got that car towed.
Oh, the
we were too concerned about driving it. I was like, no, are you sure?
It's electric.
Why was it towed, though?
I don't know. Strange. He let me drive all these other cars, but that one particular car, he was very nervous about.
Oh, okay. Like he...
It's nice.
And I've driven cars that are like triple the value of that car.
Didn't trust you.
I guess.
No, it's not bad. At that point...
Well,
I think maybe the customer probably paid a little bit more.
It was winter.
It's definitely not your boss that did that. The customer paid a bit more to get that towed to the place.
It was a wrap.
I think if I'm someone that's getting a car like that, yeah, I would definitely want to transport it by truck or however.
Yeah, you don't mile it, too. There's no
miles. Exactly. You don't want too much mileage. Who knows?
There's no miles on it.
It's just the reality of buying an expensive car. You know, you could definitely get anyone to drive
it
to you. That would be great. But some people, I saw Elon Musk buying his... McLaren F1, you can go on YouTube and you watch that. It comes in a truck. He delivers it in the suburbs. It's hilarious. You see him picking up this McLaren F1. And then the next video is him talking about crashing that car. It's like a McLaren F1. There was only like 61 ever made. He's talking about how he is I own one of those 61 cars. The next video is him talking about him crashing it. And it's so funny. He's talking about he's with one of his buddies. Or no, he's with one of the owner's partners in a major company, and the guy's just like, "So, what can this do?" He's like, "Ah, I'll show you." He's like, "He says you'll see," or some funny one-liner kind of thing, and he guns it on the highway, and then he does a turn, like he cuts into someone's lane, and just loses total control, and the car just gets totaled. It's like unbelievable. $1 million car total, and now he owns Tesla and he's shooting goddamn cars into space. Like, what the fuck kind of world are we living in? It's a cartoony world, that's for sure. Very cartoony.
Actually, it's funny you should say Tesla, because I've driven a Tesla as well.
Yeah, is it good?
And that was one car that was phenomenal, because
really
you when that's the second smooth. You press the accelerator, It just goes immediately. There's no delay.
Whenever each wheel anything, has an engine or something, or it has power in each wheel or something.
Yeah, exactly.
You and it's get power right two, away to right the away. Source. Yeah,
like. Right away. You press it. It's like, you know, normally like you press the gas and it's like,
so
go.
Is that the trend? Is that the go. Future? Is that the future? Do you see yourself driving an electric car? Kind of feel like you lose that feeling of.
Yeah, sure you do.
It is kind of strange.
That. Car or something.
It does lack driver's experience, but I gotta say it's. You know what launch control is?
Not really.
Yeah, there's
no.
cars that you can set them up. Some it varies a setting from the cars that have it, but it allows you to press the gas and it just goes like poof, right away. Like you're setting it up.
Okay.
To go as fast as possibly right. immediately.
Bro. I can bet you in like hundreds of years,
can do that.
There's going to be no, these cars that we're driving are going to be rare cars because like there's going to be less and less motor cars because of gas.
Right.
We're going to have less and less people are going to turn to electric because it's going to become affordable and it's going to become also more like there's going to be more technology into it in 100 years. So I'm 100% sure that it's going to like, it's going to switch to that. You understand
right.
what I mean? Electric
I agree,
is
yeah.
the new. It's gonna be the new source. And
actually,
those other cars, bro, they're just gonna they're gonna become like old junk or rare cars to have. And at some point, maybe only some people will be.
You know,
able
it's funny. Actually, I thought about it a while ago.
Rich people will only
I
be
think
able to have.
We could all agree that oil is not the way to
It'll
go.
It'll be so expensive.
Like realistically, like in general, like
For
we
sure.
could have went electric straight up if
a
we
long
wanted
time
to.
Ago,
I'm sure
yeah.
a long time ago, like
one
if
issue
we had the
is
technology.
This. For a lot of transport. You need immediate recharge.
Right.
Right? So electricity, until only recently, did not permit you to go very far without needing a recharge.
Yeah, for sure.
And in trucking, your time is actually your
yeah,
money.
Yeah.
So it would it would all, if that were to go that way, it's either.
Elon
it
Musk
would,
is building building trucks.
Yeah,
you need something that you
slowly
need
it's gonna
immediate
have that.
Charge.
Exactly.
That time you're losing.
There is a
is,
Tesla
well,
truck.
It's going to be like, this is how I'm going to see it. Those trucks are going to have like some generator with full battery that once it goes low, it like charges it back.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Why can't it charge itself while it drives?
Oh, it can. At some
that's
point,
the
it
thing
can.
I don't understand.
With the brakes, you can charge
why,
it.
In this
back.
Day and age, the technology should be there.
Yeah. Now, here's one huge problem with that is because the amount of resistance it creates to charge that quickly is very difficult, right? Imagine you're trying to disperse enough energy to recharge it. You're going to be losing. Anyways, it's very complicated.
Well,
but what I think might be more of a resolution would be you get batteries, a battery station. They would go to a gas station, and then there would just be a universal large battery. And this would be really only necessary for transport, you know, so they can actually continue their commute. This battery comes out, another one goes in, goes out. So it's an immediate charge station. The battery just comes
so,
out. And a new
okay,
one is put
what
in.
If the truck already had that battery and could just switch itself in it? You know, it have many in it, filled up, ready to go, and then when one dies, switch to the other one.
Wouldn't that eventually run
and
out?
And then, nah, man. If you had like some loaded, almost like an ammo roulette thing, where it'd be like perfect. That'd be some crazy technology.
Well,
to
you're talking about what everyone would like is endless well, power, like power that just never.
You know
needs.
What's crazy though is that I think that from what I'm saying, I'm oil. Has been around for 100 years, let's say, or maybe
right.
a little bit longer, and that's what we've been using for to power a
yeah.
lot of things. A lot of things we use oil.
Yeah, yeah. No,
pretty much everything has oil inside, but specifically for cars, we've been using oil for a long time. But I think, like what you were saying,
even
Vince,
to
like
make plastic,
electricity
bro.
Is gonna outweigh the time we've been using oil. So if who knows, like hopefully a volcano doesn't fucking explode.
Yo, did
and,
you see they
or,
make plastic with hemp too? That
sure.
dissolves in like within 8 months.
Definitely.
That's how fast it dissolves.
No, but.
So, like, that's good for the environment.
That too. Eventually, we're going to go down
that.
Are
we not using
Everyone's
going
to be okay with using hemp, and then next thing you know, hemp is going to be in everything. Clothing should. There's no reason why we can't
it's
use
hemp.
To
hemp
grow
is one of the
too,
best
bro.
Materials.
It's a fucking plant.
It's very. It can either be very resistant, very soft. It can be.
It's one of the most versatile plants.
Exactly, most versatile
and
plant.
And it's crazy because it's so different from the female version of the plant, which is weed or marijuana or whatever you want to call it. And the male plant is hemp, and you could just do so much with hemp. Hemp's... And it was illegal for a long time, hemp, the use of hemp in the U.S., and the U.S. had to buy their hemp from Canada. But, I mean, it's not the same thing, you know.
Well, what that goes down to is this. From my understanding, is they did that because there was so many cotton producers in the U.S., and to save the market, they attacked marijuana.
That's what you heard?
Yeah. And this DACA.
What does the cotton have to do with anything, though?
Okay, think of it like this. It was a lot of people with slaves, and they had the picking the cotton fields.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Actually, so I do understand what you're trying to say. Like,
so now you have.
They were using a lot of cotton at that time.
Imagine you're a cotton producer, right? And someone comes up and he's like, yo, this new product here is better. It's stronger. It'll last longer. Instead of a t-shirt wearing out so quickly, it'll be good forever. Like, it was a super material that's in direct competition with you.
Yeah.
Now there's some controversial topics around the plant. You talk to your politician buddies, and they were able
to... So hear me out. This is what I got on my side. This is what I heard. It was the newspaper companies that were also upset because you could make paper with hemp, and all the newspaper... The machines that they were using to print out the newspaper at that time was all with different material. It was not hemp. They would have to create new machines for the hemp, and the newspaper companies were not down to create new machines. They said, fuck that, we have what we want, we have here, you know what, we're gonna create a bunch of stories against that product. So I'm guessing the cotton industry and the newspaper industry teamed up, and you know, they just created stories like marijuana kills people and blah blah blah, the Mexicans are going crazy. It's all propaganda and brainwash the people, and they definitely succeeded. Exactly. they succeeded. Because there's still a lot of people that are alive, these older people that are in their 80s, 70s, they think this is the devil's drug, oh my God. You're only starting to get people that are opening up 50, 60 years old. And if you haven't, unfortunately, you're living in the past, and you're the type of person that's, you're not embracing the new reality, technology, and everything.
But we have the science to back it up now, with the internet, just go do your research. There's no lie, you know, you can find literally all the information you need.
Everything is out there. Like,
to know.
Personally, when I found out that marijuana was never killed anyone and it never, like, no one ever overdosed, when I found that out, those facts, I smoked a little bit before, but when I found that out, I was like, wow, I was so lied to. Like, every time before, I thought I was doing something so bad. I wasn't sure, like, you know, I enjoyed it. I was like, then I find out it's like the best thing for you. Like, not best thing, but it literally is like zero, nothing can go wrong, basically. You could take this and...
Not entirely
I understand
true.
It could hinder you in certain ways if you overdo it and you can... If you misuse it.
Any vice could be a problem, right?
You could eat too many cheeseburgers at McDonald's and that's a problem.
That's it.
But see, no one's saying anything.
Are hamburgers now going to kill people? I mean, that's it.
Well, it can, actually. That's the thing. Like, you could eat like 10 hamburgers and probably have a heart attack if you do that.
Well, that's what I'm trying to say. I mean, you can't... anything in excess is bad for you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But how is
guess
it that they should label everything?
You could smoke 1,000 joints and be fine. And that's just...
I'm not sure about fun. I'm pretty sure you'd feel like shit.
You'd feel like shit. It comes back down to the edible situation, overdoing it. Like, you just...
Overdoing anything. I like chocolate. Overdose. If I ate too much of it, I'd feel like shit.
Definitely. Yeah. I agree. That's so true.
I mean, milk is legal, but your body goes in panic mode if you drink... I think
well,
it's
Vince
like a...
has other things about milk. He says it's like really processed. It's it's just a lot of hormones and stuff that goes into that. And
yo, it's crazy that we still even drink milk.
It's like coming out of a cow.
I actually don't really drink that much.
Yeah, why are we still drinking milk?
Why do we drink
baby
milk? I have no idea.
Because, now here's another one.
It's baby food, bro, for the cows.
Because the people
a lot
that...
A lot of the food that you got was negotiated between terms of... Think of it like this, okay? So the dairy people, they associated with the... The stat. I'm gonna butcher the story. I'm not gonna have any stats correct.
Okay,
but what I'm trying to say is, they teamed up with who regulates
corporations.
Say Health Canada. They say that you should have X amount of portions of milk, X amount of portions of veggies, X amount of portions of meat.
Yeah.
And that would stabilize the industry, right? So you're just telling people, we're Health Canada. You need to eat these things. Therefore, they get sold. Jobs still goes in. I mean, people are eating the cheese, and say you have cheese and milk, you're like,
that's
oh, perfect.
True.
I'm getting my serving of the day.
Yeah,
I need this in
it's
my. I need
bullshit.
This in my,
yeah,
in my
you
diet.
Don't even
but
need
you don't
it.
Necessarily need it.
No, you don't.
But isn't it proven that
You can get everything Health Canada, out of all the rest of the foods.
The food, that statistic thing that you're talking about, what is it? The chart, the food chart. Yeah, it's totally flawed. Like they tell you to eat a bunch of bread and a bunch of fucking bread, milk. Like it's all horrible shit. Like, yeah, it's like not the best thing.
It's really true. It's
not the greatest stuff that they tell you to eat. You know what they do, bro? For a long time they were telling you to eat all that.
Thing people have to understand is that I've always said is that it doesn't fit everybody. Like all the diet, they can't be just one diet fits everybody. Everybody's different. Like you can be lactose intolerant, gluten intolerant, and you can like, I don't know, bro. Like you don't need the same shit as I do and other people. Like I know people that drink constantly milk and they have no problem, you know, but it might hit them later or whatever, but we're all made different.
You know? But there's some people we're that all have made different. There some people that have issues with, you know, they don't realize that there's a lot of, they have inflammation caused by them eating too much bread or drinking milk or something, one of those types of things, and cut that out and you're going to feel a lot better. But the thing is, most people don't realize that, like, you just cut one or two of these types of things out and you're going to really just feel a lot better. Like, some people have major issues. They have skin problems. They have just major problems.
Bro, liver problems, bro.
And you gotta try things out sometimes.
Blood problems, bro. Heart problems.
One thing I could say is this. Like, on the Joe Rogan podcast, someone mentioned, like when people are depressed, they get prescribed, antidepressants, right? And Joe Rogan, the guy's like asking Joe Rogan, is that the right thing? And Joe Rogan straight up told the guy, he's like, I don't think that's the right thing. I don't think it's the right thing either, but like, why it's not the right thing is because you didn't try all diet, exercise, like all these other things. You jump right onto this pill.
Yeah.
And it just, this is the type of world we live in these days. Like, here, try this pill. Oh, you feel shitty? Try this pill. Yeah. Here you go. And then the problem is someone gets hooked on these pills and then the doctor stops prescribing the pill.
They need it.
They go to the black market and they, next thing you know, it's heroin laced with fentanyl. That's a fucking horse tranquilizer that kills people, that could kill a whale. This is all shit that was on the Joe Rogan podcast, and I'm just repeating what they said. But to me, it all made sense. I'm like, we live in this fucked up world where it's like, nope, you cannot smoke joints. Oh, this year it's legal, and then, oh, but you can't grow it and a whole bunch of things. It's just like we're still living in a very corrupt system.
Well, I don't know about that. I mean, I understand exactly why. The weed,
I'm just like, I'm skeptical with what's going on here. Like,
well, they want to control the market, and I get it. They want the tax dollars. They didn't make weed legal because they wanted you to smoke a joint. They made weed legal because they want to make money. And for them to make money, I mean, in the financial state that the country is right now.
My drummer had mentioned the other day, like, there's bigger problems to worry about. Like, definitely legalize weed, but just do it and that's it. Don't make such a big thing about it. Just fucking legalize it and then go tackle other problems. Get those fentanyl drugs off the fucking streets that are killing people left, right, and sideways. Why isn't more attention put on that? Because there's a bigger jump on people taking prescription pills and opioids than ever. And to be honest, like, I've never taken any of that shit. I'll never touch that shit. But I know a lot of people that it's not that I know people that are taking it, but you're hearing more and more people are getting involved in these things. And why do you need it? Apparently, it makes you smarter in some ways, but fuck that. Let your brain do what you got to do. Don't fucking depend on some pill. I don't know. It's crazy.
No, I definitely hear you there.
It's really fucked up. It's fucked up because weed, it's just a form of brainwashing. We've been brainwashed our whole life, and now it's legalized. And
he's Snapchatting.
No, I'm watching a Snapchat.
All right, I think it's time to wrap it up.
Yeah, man, we've been here for, I don't know. Yeah, we need a clock now, if we're still unsure.
Yeah. It's 11:45.
Fuck, you're kidding me.
What time is it?
11:45.
No,
okay,
it's 10:45.
10:45. Oh, the time might have changed.
Oh, the time.
No, only at midnight it goes.
So it's 11:45?
Yeah, so it's still 10:45, but 10:45. When it hits 1 a.m., I think
you
it goes back
an
to
hour
12.
The weekend.
That sucks.
When it hits 1 a.m., it goes back to 12. I'm pretty
sure.
Yeah,
we're going to change the time. We're going to mess with your circadian rhythm. It's all good. It's all good. It's meant to be. We do this.
No, we win an hour on our sleep.
It's unhealthy. Japan, they did a study and they said that changing the hour back and forth, it's not a healthy thing.
We don't even see the hours anyways.
They say it's for farmers. We live in a winter society. Where are they farming anything?
Well, we don't
in
even
winter?
See
like,
time. It doesn't exist. It doesn't so make sense. We didn't back up time technically because we can't control time. So we're still in the same time.
Yes, understand? I agree.
Just don't think about time. Just think about I'm living.
No, I know that, but it's hard to do that because your body has a circadian rhythm that you follow.
People, you know, native people, the First Nations, right. These people don't live with times and years at all. They live with memories.
Just talk into them. Mike.
Sorry. They live with memories. So what that mean is that, like, they're not like, oh, remember in 2009 when there was, like, 9/11 and blah, blah, blah. They don't see that. They remember the memory. There's no time attached to it. You understand? They don't see time. It's not there. There's no numbers. Because for them, you can't measure time. There's no start and there's no end to it. So it's like you can't really measure it. But we're trying to measure it. Like, people like us try to measure time.
Why, though? It doesn't make sense that we do this.
It's just, they don't see it that way. They don't see it. And I learned it in school, and I was like, that makes sense. But it's crazy how, like, try to live a different way now. You can't, because, like, we're so used to the white.
We created time.
The white people living type of thing.
I mean, time doesn't exist. It's like, we created age. We created.
Well, that's it. That's where I find
time. The world is spinning.
When you live with time,
yes,
it fucks you.
And
bro.
It is.
It fucks you. You always think you're late and everything when you think there's no time, technically. We're just all living in this.
Well, I don't think. Yeah.
The day.
It's good to be, like, on point and on track.
That's when everybody eats at 12. Like, that when you go, restaurants are full at 12. It's like everybody eats at 12. It's almost like that's the time, you know. It's weird. Me, I don't eat with time. It's when I'm hungry I eat. Like, I there's no time anymore. I don't see it that way. I don't know for you
what
guys,
about the Egyptians? Did they believe in time? I think time was a factor. They did have Horus, which was the god of the sun, or time, the god of time. I'm not sure exactly what happened.
They definitely did document, yes.
Yeah, time did matter. It mattered. So, I mean, no, there's something about time, definitely.
There's
we're moving in
maybe,
some type of pattern. We're in a present state.
For sure.
I think what the problem is too much people are thinking about the future and the past and not worrying about what they're
present,
doing right then and there.
Yeah.
Because at that point, I agree, time shouldn't matter because you're living so much in the present. But if you're too worried about your future events coming up and the past, you're not living in the present, and then time does become a factor and you're letting it control your life at that point. Time, people don't realize that it's such a big thing. Like, we could do a lot more with our time. So some people that don't go to the gym, they're like, I got no time. You got time. You got time. Just take
TV,
the time,
time,
figure it out where that That's 1 hour in the day that you're not doing anything, and then pick it and do it. You don't have to go every day. Go 2-3 times a week.
Well, there's a lot of things in time that I find strange, don't you? Like, there's, for example, the way our calendar works, right? The calendar, some months are 30 days, some months are 31 days, some months are 28.
Yeah, how does that work? That's
how does that
so
work?
Weird.
Why does
I don't
it
know.
Do it? There's another. It's an interesting thing. It's 13 months.
Okay.
So it would be 13 months, and they would all be 28 days. So the first of the month would always be Sunday, and then so forth. So you'd always know that exact same day, and there'd be only one extra day in this. So it'd be 13 months plus an extra day, and that extra day would be New Year's, and it'd be like an additional holiday that the world would kind of have all off. It sounds pretty cool. You see what I mean? Like 28 days.
We're starting
13
a new
months.
Revolution, bro.
What?
Right now, we're starting.
Let's
this.
Do it.
So
new
we
calendar.
We all start living that way.
13 month calendar challenge.
We promoted new calendar. Yeah. We try that new calendar. Everybody's gonna be
everyone's
fucked.
On
that
it.
It's Christmas. It's like
applying
nah, dude,
a new calendar.
Yet.
It's like fuck. You have to check the other calendar
you
every
tell
day.
Your,
like, God damn it.
Yeah, at work you're like, nah, man. Today is the 28th.
Yeah, man. Sorry, I'm off today. It's Sunday. It's like, whoa.
It's funny.
Sorry, man. It's Sunday today.
Yeah, you'll never be able to change it.
It's like
in
Seinfeld, the guy has like a holiday. He invents a holiday. We invent a calendar.
Whew, that'd be a difficult one. I mean, really, the Christian.
That's
one,
like fucking inventing time at that point. I think let's let the people that did that,
that
take care of that. We don't have to worry
too
much.
Is when Jesus is born.
What?
Day one,
yeah.
When this Like the calendar, the way it works is.
Oh, of course, because that's for sure when time was created. That's
it's a strange measurement that we go with that.
It totally makes sense.
What I understood is if January 1st is the day he was born, wasn't he only born December 25th? Like, isn't Christmas his birthday? So doesn't time. I mean.
But
time start at
what's funny is that there's so many different prophecies about the same thing, and people don't understand that it's all about solar, like has everything to do with the solar patterns and the stars. Like, yes, it does. Like, you're translating a story into.
Would you imagine pitching religion to anyone today? Like a new religion, like you just said,
it's probably happening every day. What are you talking about? This happens every day. The new religion's popping up all the time, I'm sure. Mm.
But aren't they all variations off, like, Christianity-based? It's all, like, another religion, but it's slightly... No?
I guess. Yes, that's exactly what's going on. They're just like tweaking it a little bit and creating another...
Rastafarism.
I mean, I'm not against any religion.
No, I'm not against any religion. I'll do whatever you gotta do. I'm totally... It's not about that. I'm just saying, like, you know, at one point, you gotta just...
I mean, what
religion is saying in general, like, I do agree with, like, be happy, live a positive life. There's a lot of good that's said in religion, but it's just the people that take it a little bit too much, just a little bit too much. And that is where you got to kind of be like, yo, you know, those types of people that they create some religion where it's like,
extreme.
A religion where it's like, oh, you got to bang the fucking, the head guy, every chick has to bang that. It's, hey, you want to join this religion? This is part of the thing.
That's
and it's like, hey, that fucking shit all happens all the time. Oh, all the time.
Yeah.
You know what I'm trying to say? I don't know if you know what I'm trying to say. Like, someone starts a religion. I am the God.
Well, think of it like this.
And then
think,
everyone praises that one
imagine
person.
Imagine when it was the pyramids, okay? Yeah. Pharaohs and all that shit. The pharaohs were God.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They were the gods. They were a representation of God on Earth.
Okay, yeah.
How did they pitch that?
Yeah.
That was the best sell ever. Be like, yo, like
the
I'm
Greek
God,
gods,
dude.
Too.
I just forgot to tell you, I'm God, and you know, you guys are all my slaves, and you have my blessing is like you're not gonna die with. How did that happen? Or like the first king? How did that happen? Like, hey guys, I'm gonna be the king. Okay, and you guys are gonna pay me all taxes. I can take all the gold. Like, I'll have all the best food and everything in this massive house that you guys will pay for.
Everything good.
I think it was the
you guys give it all to me.
Don't worry. It won't only be me, King. It's just whoever my offspring is will become royalty permanently. So, like, none of you guys will ever have this. Only my family will ever have this. Okay, I'm good at that.
So
what do you think, guys?
Or the Mayans. I visited.
The first leader.
I visited Chichen Itza.
How did the first leader
in,
do it?
I visited Chichen Itza,
yeah,
in Mexico.
It was like click when you think about it. Like, I think how it worked, it was like someone created like this click, made them believe this, that he was powerful, probably the strongest. And then since there was less people on Earth, they probably like gathered towards this click, which made it like they had no choice but to follow or else they would like probably kill.
Like, you were the king
they
of the entire country.
So like, if you follow or you kill, and then at some point like that guy grew a bunch of fans and that's his kingdom.
In the Mayan religion, there's a sport that's played,
like this,
okay? I don't know if you've ever seen it in like the movies or anything, but it's like two hoops on the each side and they're really high up on these like really high walls and they have to like kick a ball into the hoop. And it's almost like hacky sack with a ball, but you got to kick it into the hoop. It's like soccer or basketball, but the hoop is like, instead of it being like this, it's parallel. And basically, it's super high up.
Parallel or horizontal?
Horizontal, sorry. Horizontal. And basically, the messed up part is the captain in the winning team gets his head chopped off. And that's part of the ritual or whatever you want to call it. So, like, let's say you're the captain and your team wins.
Oh my God.
You get your head chopped off.
No, lose.
If you win. That's the weird part. It's
so
like the guy's
lose.
Explaining it. He's like, you're the winner of, and you're the captain
so you,
of the
no
winning team. You get your head chopped off. It's like an honor thing.
So
you
no
get
one
your
plays.
Head chopped off.
What?
So let's
Are you
say
sure about that?
So like both
yeah.
team
win. Let's say you're like a Conor McGregor type guy.
How does that make sense,
in the Mayan
bro?
You're super like and you win, you're like super fit athlete type of guy, you're getting your head chopped off. You were good for one game. You're done. And I don't know how it works when you become captain. Saying? Maybe it takes a long time. What I believe, they thought maybe it was an honor thing. And I'm not going to diss anything because that's what they believe. But God, that's damn. Fucked up,
no,
man.
But like, how is it the winning?
And that's what they—that's like, what so I don't I understand, dude. I wish I could this tell you that. Listen. I'm telling you, man. I visited the spot where it happened. It was in Chichen Itza, Mexico. Chichen Itza, oh, you've been there.
Yeah.
The guy, it was a guide. They explained the story. It's like the winning team gets his head chopped off. And to me, that's unreal.
And
that's
there was people in the crowd too on the sides, right?
Why would you
I think so. It was definitely like a stadium.
They were kicking in the hole there?
The hole was on the side.
As like a ball. It was a special ball
I've
made out of something.
Game, but I didn't know they
special material.
High up too, these things.
Yeah, it's crazy high up. You saw it then. Yeah, if you've been there, you witnessed it. And no, that's been
winning captain. I'd be like, who wants to be captain? I'm good.
That's what I'm thinking. Like,
no,
who
you're
wants to be captain. It's same thing with being the
they would obviously
being
lose on purpose,
king.
Bro.
You know, it's like there's
how
a lot
you,
of weird things
I'd be
there.
Like, ah man, did I miss again?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. No one wants to get it in. They're
well,
constantly
I mean,
missing.
If I wasn't the captain, I wouldn't really care.
Imagine you score your team scores and you look at the guy like, you asshole, if you're gonna get me killed, you know? It's like
I never liked you anyways.
Yeah, no, it's like I'm gonna kill you. You're going to die anyway. I was like, what the fuck? How cynical is that? I mean,
well, it was all, it's a bit feel like everything was religion based because there was no understanding of the world. Everything was.
Well, you could see how that can happen. I mean, zero technology,
well,
no.
It goes like that for anything. Anything that is common knowledge is.
But see, that's where it's weird. It's like, what's knowledge to us? They had knowledge that we don't know. Like, how the fuck did they create these pyramids?
Just
how
like
they
we were
create...
saying before. You
Yo,
know
it says, after the game, one of the brothers was decapitated and his head was used as the game ball.
What?
From the decapitated trunk of the player, blood escaped in the form of snake. This blood was taken as a symbol of... And then I can't see
the snake is a big symbol for these guys.
Oh, my God.
They would use the head, chop off the guy's head, and... All right, round two. Round two. They need their head.
Yeah.
That's what it's used for, I guess.
Oh, my God.
Damn. That's crazy.
I would never want to play that game. I'm like, you know what? I don't want to risk being captain.
I'm cool here. I'm cool with the...
With
cleaning
up. That's what it said, bro. The master. From the decap... Yeah, they said the scene is depicted in relief on the wall of MPG
and they keep playing?
Court,
so
such
the
as the most famous example.
Hey, you want to join?
Itza,
no,
in Mexico.
I'm good.
Yeah, bro, I knew it was these wall things.
It's fucked up, man.
Look, it said the Maya ball game originated more than 3,000 years ago, bro. That's old.
3,000 years
ago. And the rulers and mentioned the important position of the Maya ball game. Through this ball game, a conflict of the force of darkness and light is
okay,
described.
Okay, yes, that's what it is. It's a sacrifice. That's what it is. It's not a... It's
By
a sacrifice.
By tradition, the twin
that's
brothers Hun Hanapu and Xablanc used their time on Earth to play ball. Through the noise of the game, the anger of Vukub came. The master of the underworld was aroused. A fight ensued from which resulted in the information of the blah, blah, blah. And that's the rest, bro. That's crazy. You were right, but like, it was like a sacrifice or something.
So you guys down to end this?
Yeah, I guess we could.
Yeah,
it
right.
was also a sacrificial and religious event. You're right. That's what it says here.
Yeah, it's a sacrifice, definitely. I just...
It said the Maya believed that it was necessary to play the game for their own survival.
Really? They believed that game was part of their survival.
The ball game provided an opportunity to show devoutness, is that how you say it? To the gods by sacrificing captured kings Maybe. And high lords or the losing
it?
Opponents of the games. That's what it said.
Shit. That's crazy. We're losing an hour tonight. I'm just going to adjust
right now. Yeah. Unfortunately, but we're gonna end this podcast. Music starts now. Peace, Vince. Peace, Noel.
Peace. It was.
We'll
fun.
Be back.
Peace.
This was a good one. This was a good back. We're gonna adjust everything
I'm not
a lot
even
better.
In it, bro, the whole time.
Yeah, you kind of were out of the shot though at the end.
I was
when you came back.
I'm in prime spot.
Vince was playing the role as the factual getter. He was getting the facts for us.
Yeah,
I should be the computer guy.
You're the Jamie, young Jamie of the Benny K. Bauer. Hey, thanks so much, man.
Benny K.
Hey,
Bauer.
Peace, man.
Over and
out.